Thank you, Alex. So, yeah, well, as Alex just mentioned, I'll be talking a little bit about some work that we've been doing in collaboration with Los Alamos, and it concerns inversion of integral transformations. But what is important is that these problems naturally occur when we're dealing with certain experimental techniques. So first, I want to acknowledge the other people involved in this collaboration. These are Dr. Bojan Aleksandrov and Kim Rasmussen, both from Los Alamos, and Dr. Ravi Vangara, who was my graduate student, and then he did a postdoc with Los Alamos and started working on these problems. So, what is the claim that we're making? We're proposing a new method for analysis of dynamic light scattering data. And the method addresses a problem that, in fact, is crucial for the application of the techniques. And this problem also quite often prompts people to abandon the method and try to characterize polydispersed particle samples using different techniques. So by polydisperse, I mean that we are having particles that are distributed in terms of size. So they are not very monodispersed, they are not just all the same size, but there is a distribution which may or may not be a problem. So, for example, if the distribution is monomodal, which means that there is some width of the size distribution, but again, it is all centered around dominant size, it is not that bad. But if we are having particle mixtures and their different peaks all mixed into the same sample, then suddenly this becomes a really, really difficult problem. And to add more complexity, as you can imagine, when you are dealing with experimental data, there is always some noise and uncertainty that's related to the accuracy of the method. So all these add up to the difficulties. And here is what the experimental setup is. It's a very primitive schematics, but this is these are like according to the best drawing abilities that I have. But what the method does, you take a sample, which is this cuvette here. This should be a cuvette filled with dispersion of some suspended particles in solution. And we shoot a laser beam through the sample. And as you can imagine, light gets scattered in all directions. Some of it, of course, will travel through, but there will be a lot of scattering to the sides. And one thing that is important to mention right here is that the intensity of the scattered light depends on the angle. And this is something that is in fact quite useful because the fraction of scattered light at small angles somewhere here, they usually probe and detect particle motions, random Brownian motions that are on a relatively large length scale and long time scale. As you're moving from small angles, and while here we are reaching 90 degrees and we can go even further, then we are probing motions, collective motions of the particles on smaller length scales and faster time scales. In fact, if you have the suitable particle size, one can look at collective diffusion of many particles, so for like which is equivalent of a propagation of a gradient at the smaller angles, and then you can go all the way down to probing the motion of individual particles. So that would be the Stokes-Einstein diffusion. One thing that's important here to point out is that at least at this stage, we try to avoid particle interactions, which is not always possible, but in many cases it is. So particle interactions are typically avoided, and that's done by diluting the sample. So there is some opposing trends here. On one hand, you need to have sufficient number of particles so that they scatter enough light that could be detected reliably. But on the other hand, you don't want to have too many particles that interact with some interparticle interactions. And even worse, you want to avoid multiple scattering. So the dynamic light scattering experiment in its classical setup relies on scattering from individual particles. In other words, a photon hits the particle, gets scattered to the side, and doesn't hit anything else along the way. If it hits another particle, then the experiment is compromised. So everything is in this limit here, which is known as the Rayleigh scattering. And it is a complicated fraction, but what is important here is that we have the angular dependence of the scattered light, we have dependence on the wavelength, and we have also dependence on the particle radius. Usually the wavelength is fixed because if you want to go through different wavelengths, this means that you'll add a lot of price to the instrument. So typically they work with a single monomodal laser, but the quality of the beam is important. Nowadays, people are using mostly helium neon lasers. And because they have a wavelength of the wavelength is 632.8, I think, nanometers. They are very well designed, these sources, to probe particles that are within the size limits of about a nanometer all the way up to 1,000 nanometers. These are the current limits of the modern instruments. So what the instrument detects here, you place a photomultiplier somewhere along the, like facing the beam, and it detects something like this. So this is like a fluctuating intensity of the scattered light. And the reason that it fluctuates is because if this is the observation volume zoomed in here, particles are going in and out. So at some point you may have more scatterers. At other point in time, you may have less scatterers, and the intensity of the scattered light will fluctuate. And of course, the more scatterers you have, the greater the signal. And it looks very random, but in fact, if a time correlation is performed, which is we multiply the intensity at some moment, T, and then we multiply it by the intensity of some moment later in time, which is T plus tau, and we integrate over all possible T's here, we will find something that is known as the intensity correlation function. And it turns out that it behaves as a very nice exponential here. And in the coefficient here in front of the time, there are two things. One is the wave vector, which is angular dependent, and the other is the diffusion coefficient. So it is the diffusion coefficient that we're after, because the diffusion coefficient can next be related to the particle size. So when you look at particle size distribution obtained using dynamic light scattering, it is done through first measuring the diffusion coefficient and then going to the particle size using the Stokes-Einstein relationship. But what is important here is this exponential behavior, and this is what you'll be measuring if all particles have exactly the same size and they do not interact, which is rarely the case. In fact, quite often, and particularly if someone is involved in particle synthesis, and they want to characterize their sample, they want to know what is the polydispersity. In other words, what is the size distribution? And if we treat each particle as an individual and independent scatterer, which means there are no particle interactions, neither true physical interactions between the particles, nor optical, like multiple scattering, we can sum up all these individual correlation functions, autocorrelation functions, and multiply them by this coefficient, which is the number of particle of type I that has diffusion coefficient di. And if we sum all of them, we'll get the overall effective correlation function. And basically, this is what we are measuring, the left-hand side of this equation. And if the variations between the particles are not that big, we can go from summation to integration. So again, this is the this integral is what we are measuring as an effective averaged autocorrelation function, and it is averaged over the size distribution or the diffusion coefficient distribution here, which is A of D. And again, we can relate the diffusion coefficient to the radius using this Stokes-Einstein relationship. So what we have in an experiment is measuring this function, the autocorrelation function. We know that each particle of given size autocorrelates according to this exponential. So this is what we know, this is what we measure, but unfortunately, this is what we are after. So we have this classical ill-posed problem, which is you're measuring an integral, but want to be able to say something about the integrand. And you know that you can have many integrands, different functions, which when integrated will give you the same value for the integral. And that's where the problem relies. Another thing that one probably sees when looking at this integral is that this is essentially like an inverse Laplace transform. And it's quite logical to say, well, we can do a numerical inverse Laplace transform similarly to using the fast Fourier transform techniques. After all, the Laplace transform can be derived from the Fourier transform. So how different could it be? And the answer is it could be very different. And turns out that the Laplace inversion is extremely sensitive to noise, to the point that there is a resistance in the light scattering community among many people to use this technique to characterize very polydispersed or multi-model distributed particle samples. And in fact, some people have compared this trick that is built in light scattering instruments as black art and basically don't trust it. So this is where we try to make a difference. And our approach very briefly is the following. We look at a complex distribution that have many different particle sizes and particle modes and present it as a sum of Gaussians. They may not be Gaussians. We can pick any distribution, for example, log normal or something else. But it's not that important, as it turns out, because you can represent a complex distribution as a sum of other functions. And we present our, so this is our correlation function. Turns out that it can be rewritten in this form as a sum of Gaussians. And it is a sum of these functions that depend on angles, of course, the time, a number of particles. This is the dispersion in the, this is the mean, the diffusion coefficient. This is the variance. And I will go directly to the results. So we have done the following. We simulated distributions and tried to fit them with this machine learning algorithm, which tries to find, first of all, it tries to identify the number of modes in the particle distributions, and then how the points cluster around those nodes. And what you see here at the bottom is a simulation for a monomodal distribution here. So the points are the simulated distributions. The line is the one that's recovered through our technique. This is not a big accomplishment, because a distribution like this will be most likely recovered from most built-in softwares that are used in today's light scattering instruments that are commercially available. However, the next one, you have this trimodal distribution that had three distinct peaks. And as you can see, this the actual simulated distribution is very well reproduced by the machine learning minimization and clustering that we have used to find what the distribution should look like. And this is quite striking to me, because it is very unlikely to be able to resolve three different peaks. Two are more or less doable with different techniques, but three is really interesting. Not only that, but the current techniques, for example, the one that's most common right now, it's called Contin. In fact, it tends to give a bimodal distribution, even for an actual distribution that might not be bimodal, but can be weirdly shaped with like a really long tail towards large particle sizes and things like that. And what really surprised us quite a bit is that we were able to resolve four different peaks here in this distribution. And that was really quite impressive to me, because I don't know of a current method that can do that. And the top panels, by the way, these are the machine learning analysis for the error. What you see here is that this thing that's called silhouette, which basically describes how points cluster around certain centers. In our case, that would be the value of the peaks here for the particle size. But this is the criteria. So our algorithm, first of all, can tell us how many peaks are there, which is something that's quite nice. And you can see this from the analysis of the error. What you see is this sharp change, this drop at the number of peaks, which in this case is three, in this case is four. So that's where we are. And what we did next was we collected experimental data, but also we got in touch with Malvern. In fact, they contacted us thanks to the marketing campaign that's done by the STC. Malvern is a big British company that makes light scattering instruments, different types. And they also sent us data that we plan to play with. But this method is not only relevant to dynamic light scattering. Turns out that integrals like these, clearly, they are the output of a dynamic light scattering experiment. But something similar happens when a time-resolved fluorescent spectroscopy experiment is done. There is a similar integral, just the kernel of the transform is not an exponential like in our case, but a different function. Mass spectrometry, it can have the similar problems. You may have to do this inversion, which I just talked in the beginning of this integral. Positron annihilation spectroscopy, same integral appears there. Nuclear magnetic resonance, another example. And something that is not directly related, but it is also something that can be treated in the same way. This is determining the membrane pore size distribution, which is another problem, which mathematically is very simple. It's another ill-posed problem. So these are other potential applications of this technique. And like I said, currently we are in some contact with Malvern in the UK. And we are looking for potential collaborations or licensing. We'll see how things will go. But they sent us tons of data last week or the week before that. No, actually, it was a little earlier, but we are just starting to look into those, because there were other commitments that both my Los Alamos collaborators had and myself. but they send us a lot of data. So we will see how we'll be able to treat those data, and we'll take it from there.